and their interests are secure, both privacy-wise. I'm going to be talking about four things in my speech today. Firstly, I'm going to talk about how citizens give active consent towards this policy to begin with. Secondarily, I'm going to talk about the parental responsibility of towards citizens of the government and the state. Thirdly, I'm going to argue on the point of utilitarianism and why, on a utility perspective, we're going to give you marginal benefits coming about from this particular motion. And lastly, I'm going to give you impact and what changes with respect to the status quo in today's world. Firstly, the idea of what is the active consent. When citizens go out to vote in different elections, they vote upon governmental policies, which means that a particular political campaign sets out a manifesto, for example, and the citizens are supposed to read it and then give in their vote, thereby signaling a direct relationship with their agreement to the policy of the government in place. Which is to say, that if the government tomorrow decides to have a certain policy with respect to accumulating your data or, you know, keeping an eye on their citizens' records on the global media and the internet, for that example, will not be taken up in a court of law as a breach of privacy simply because you have an active consent and an agreement between two parties to begin with. Secondarily, on the idea of a parental responsibility for the state to begin with, we think that the state acts as a parent to a child in general, which means that they are the best people that can take a decision as to what is best for the citizens or not, given that all citizens at every single point in time during this debate will act as irrational actors in this debate, and the only rational actor which can take rational decisions is the state. At a point in time when you need to secure your interests and you need to secure the safety of your own people, the only person and the only entity who is going to be largely responsible and also effective by doing so is going to be the state or the government, given that it's a rational actor to begin with. Thirdly, on the idea of why there's going to be a benefit coming about from this motion, especially given the utility perspective. Because at a point in time, when you see that things are changing and according to Steve, when you think that things are not going well, even if it's like India, for example, there are daily cases of violence increasing in different communities. We think that this motion does not only apply for international conflicts, but also as minor conflicts within different regions and different domesticated regions of a particular country for that particular matter also. At that particular point in time, given that we're all a part of a democratic setup, where we all agree to be part of a singular government, top to bottom, center to state, to the local community government, that means all of us have a utility to serve towards the government, which essentially means that the government can use us to benefit us in the larger end. We can see this happening in different spheres of life. We can see this happening in marketing. We can see this happening in healthcare. We see this happening in education, where the state takes money from us in order to give us quality education. That is also a trade-off which is acceptable. And we think the trade-off, as my time over, I'm tiring myself, I'm still at 350. Hello? I'll just continue. Given that the status quo currently...
No, you see, the bell is already rung, so you have to conclude.
Okay, fine. I'm still at 4 minutes, I think.
Yeah.
Given that the world already around us, the status quo specifically looks not really peaceful, which means there are current divides and tensions, you need a certain intervention to begin with. On opposition side, the burden on side opposition is not to simply say that the harms coming about of this motion, but to also point out why there's no need to have this particular motion in the first place. At a point in time when they don't do that, this government burden still exists and it's far better.
We are up with time.
Hi, I've been timing myself since the starting of the debate and still at 4:40. If you want to just send a screenshot, I'll send the screenshot to myself. I've been hearing the bell since the past 1.5 minutes. I was at 3 minutes and 60 seconds.
Just conclude, sir.
Yeah, just my conclude. Time is over now, bro.
I'm just giving you 20 seconds. Please conclude. Okay.
Yeah, given that the status quo in a world today is that there is a need for intervention to begin with, the burden on side opposition is not to point out the harms coming about, but rather prove to us that there is no need for this motion to exist in the first place. Extremely proud to propose. Also, like, this is a small thing I think everybody here is experienced with parliamentary debating. So could the bell please not be rung before 4 minutes, since the time is 5 minutes? It extremely hampers the debate.
Okay, we'll just keep that in
mind. It completely throws you off guard. I've been hearing the bell since 3 minutes and 50 seconds. I'm timing myself. I have a stopwatch in front of myself.
Yes, I know, sir.
To stop at 5 minutes.
Yes, sir. Suggestion noted. Thank you. It won't happen again. Okay. And that is why I gave you the extra time. Deputy Leader of Opposition, are you ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
Okay, Manpreet, let's just make it clear. Manpreet, you put a single bell at the end of 4 minutes, and at the end of 5 minutes, you ring it continuously. Okay.
I just ring on after the 4 minute of as per the rule.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, Manpreet, just do it after 4 minutes. Just ring it once, and after end of 5 minutes, just ring it twice. Okay.
Yes, sure.
Okay. Leader of Opposition, you may start now.
Yes, okay. So the Honorable Adjudicators, Honorable Leader of the Government, and everybody present here, a warm good afternoon. Firstly, I would like to start by saying that we are living in an age where everything is on internet. Most of the things are on internet, but we are living it by choice. So we are putting out our data, our personal data or whatever, by choice on any of the social media platforms, because it is our right to preserve our own information, whatever personal data we want to preserve to ourselves. And we have been to various ages like space age, jet age, and now we are in a digital age where almost every person is using these platforms. And it could be very easily traceable. I understand the government needs to keep tabs on the anti-national elements, but such vague and wide powers to the government is not an option, because they won't be able to confine themselves to the deserving targets of the anti-national elements. Will they keep themselves confined? No. They could even misuse this data for keeping tabs on the oppositions like us, or the citizens who are anti-government and they are protesting against the government, and they can misuse their personal data for various reasons. And today, personal data is the most important thing to mankind. The mankind has been striving for the protection of personal data since ages. And secondly, I would like to point out the technological aspect of it. Our technology is not advanced to the way it has to be. And because when the government stores a particular personal data of every citizen, of almost every person, it will be stored on a particular their servers or their things. But will there be security to that? There have been incidents where the anti-nationals or even the citizens for various reasons have hacked the government data. So if we put our personal data in a stored format in a very systematic manner, it will be in fact more easier for the anti-nationals or the for the world to access that data. And secondly, I would like to say that under the guise of fighting falsehood, we are ironically making more easier the task of accessing this personal data to the anti-nationals. So this is not an option. Secondly, I would like to say that there is no nothing a proper definition of personal data. But in India, it is said that any information that relates to a natural person, which either directly or indirectly in combination with other information available or likely to be available with a body corporate, is capable of identifying as such. That means any kind of data, even if it is not useful to protect the nation's security, it could be used for any purposes, for misusing it. People could get blackmailed, and there have been cases in other countries. And we have how does the government answer to this question, that where do they draw the line of sensitive information and the normal information that they need?
POI,
there is no particular right. Sorry,
POI, ma'am.
It's not a POI, but it's a normal questioning to the government, their ability to check this information. Hello, am I audible?
See, the other side can ask you a POI. It's upon you whether you want to answer that or not.
So,
ask a POI if you want.
Okay, ask. Okay, sure, go ahead.
Yeah, you said that we are making all of these information more accessible to anti-nationals, considering we are giving the information only to the government. Do you mean to say that the government is anti-national?
Not at all. I'm not saying government is national. It is questionable. I'm not interfering or interrupting in that particular aspect. It could be misused though. But I'm saying that it is accessible. If you are storing it in a particular platform or a particular machinery, it could be accessible to anybody. It could be easily traced or tracked by any person, anti-national. I'm not saying that the government is anti-national, but in fact, the people who are... If a particular terrorist organization has employed a particular person in the government, that person could easily access that. So under the guise of fighting this anti-nationalism, you are actually making the task of the terrorists more easier to access this data. So there is no need of doing, and more importantly, the personal data is very important. And in the Puttuswamy case, we have seen that it comes within the ambit of Article 21, that is right to life. That means even the Supreme Court has acknowledged the importance of the personal
Ma'am,
data.
It's fine. So it Ma'am, has to you have answered. Ma'am, you have answered. It's okay. Deputy Prime Minister, you may start. Deputy Prime Minister, are you there?
No.
Yes, please start.
Yeah, I'll just set my stopwatch 1 second. Yeah, thank you so much. Panel side opposition doesn't seem to understand one basic catch over there in this status quo, right? They have a problem with any sort of storage of data on any server and on any website. The fact that even if you don't release this information to the government, the fact that private players like Facebook, WhatsApp, or your bank accounts already have such information with them, it can always have a propensity to be misused, right? They have to come up and argue that the government will necessarily misuse this data, and that is what their case has to be. Otherwise, it will always be stored on a server. And let us not forget that the relations that governments and private players in the status quo in any country for that matter enjoy, specifically in the case of India, the way they are cock-a-hoop with Ambani, you can never discount the propensity for this kind of an operation conducting anyway. Apart from that, the other problem that they have with our case is a level of privacy compromise that already exists, right? Let us understand, when you quote the Constitution, a Constitution's clause also states that privacy can also be compromised in a situation where it is approachable and when it can be regarded by the court to be deemed worthy of it. That is to say, national sovereignty qualifies as a cause good enough to compromise on your privacy. Still, why do we give you a mechanism as to how this will go about? We will give you systematic government access to personal data. The problem that you have is that government can go ahead and misuse it. We say you can have accountability on part of the government in a twofold manner. A, you can keep tabs on how they are accessing their data and for what purpose they are accessing the data in the form of, let's say, the way you have RTIs, you can still have the same way. You can even release public documents with regards to why the government has decided to access that particular data if you want to. We don't think that is a problem. But secondly, the fact that the government wants to come into power over the next term, right? And that is the case that they try to run when they go ahead and say that you will use it to go against the opposition and take their information. Considering that there are no elections around, we don't see a reason for them to take any information from the opposition. Now, in the second case where there are elections around,
that means if the elections are near, that you will be accessing our data and misusing it. Is that, am I correct? The way you have said it.
Yes, thank you so much. Thank you so much for the POI. I got it. Now, even when there are elections on, the fact that the government wants to come into power, they will not commit a crime which they know can take and which can translate into the public voting them out of power. At that point of time, they will not take a risk of accessing data, considering if the people come to know about it, they will decide not to vote these people into power. We think there is an accountability check existing on these people. I'm not taking any more POIs. I had one compulsory POI. Thank you so much. Apart from that, what is the constructive case we give you on side government, right? We live in a world that is defined by conflict, religious conflict, communal conflicts, international conflicts. At a point of time where religious hate, terrorist activities have been propagated over the internet and international transactions paying these terrorists have been happening through the internet, we think we are ready to compromise on privacy of these people to the certain extent that the purposes of this compromise are for national sovereignty and security. Why do we tell you that? Because the burden of national sovereignty and security solely lies upon the shoulders of the government, right? At that point of time, if you hide the information that the government should be accessible to, these acts will only go ahead and propagate. We think for the right to life that side opposition wants to propagate, for this life to be safe within the country, for national sovereignty to exist within the country itself, for people like us to every day live in their homes thinking that we are safe, because there is a government keeping tabs on the activities happening within the nation, we think this is a step that we want to take. But apart from that, we've already proven to you that when a government comes into power, keeping this policy as in their manifesto, the people have the choice to go ahead and give active consent to these government to go ahead and take their data from them, right? We think at any point of time, considering that you can hold the government accountable to its actions when they're using your data, you will want safety of your own life more importantly than the privacy of your data, right? Because anyway, if there is any infringement upon that, you can hold them accountable to that. But apart from that, we go ahead and give you a simple reasoning towards our case, right? The problem we've already characterized for you exists. There is a solution we provide to you. Side opposition can obviously come up and argue to you that privacy is an important aspect of this debate, but at the same time, unless and until they have no alternative to give to you regarding how to solve the problem of safety that exists within the status quo, they can't win this debate. Because right to privacy by the constitution can be compromised to a distinguishable level if the need arises so. And anyway, we think that because the private players are already taking your information, it's not that there is absolute sanctity of the safety of your information anyway. We think that the government can still access this information through the private players, but the fact that you can have it through legal channels now is a benefit we give to you on our side of the house. Thank you very much.
Deputy Leader of Opposition.
Yes, am I audible?
Yes, you are. Please start.
So before I start, I'd like to answer the questions that were raised by the Deputy Prime Minister. Firstly, it was said that the government and the other organization and agencies have the information access. Here, the citizens or the people give the access to these government agencies and the banks. Here, the government as such is trying to interfere with the data without any consent of an individual. Secondly, when you talk about privacy invasion, here privacy is definitely getting infringed. For example, when we see a putting of a curfew in a particular area, a curfew is only put when the government sees that something wrong is happening. It just doesn't put a curfew for security reasons. So why the government wants to interfere with the data just for security reasons where there's nothing wrong happening? Also, moving forward to the constitutional values, Puttuswamy case have clearly mentioned that privacy prevails in any case, be it data security, be it privacy in any physical situation of a person. Also, Article 19(1)(a) of the Constitution clearly says a person has right, a person has liberty, freedom of speech, expression, expressing in whatever platform they want without interruption from any agency, any particular government agency as such. Also, talking about the data protection bills which were introduced in the parliament, the data protection bill was introduced in 2006, did not come into existence. The same bill with certain clauses came again in 2018, which has many which clearly states that the government can obtain and use non-personal data in order to better deliver service or develop evidence-based politics. This bill also from 2006 to 2018 and now it's still continuing as a bill just because privacy the whole point revolves here around his privacy, which is important for an individual. The IT Act or any of the constitutional articles nowhere states that it is the right or there must be a provision for the government for national security to interfere with the data of any particular individual without their consent. Also, the recently Arogya Setu app issue. If all of us have noticed that the Arogya Setu app had been rebuilt or maybe updated so many times because many people were not logging in or joining in just because of this privacy issue. Your date, your age, everything has been included in that, and which makes it very dangerous for you to live in a society where your entire data, your entire information is in the hands of someone. Now, further speaking of the data protection and privacy, here the government does not itself govern or has a look over this particular data system and the or information that we submitted to them. They definitely appoint certain agencies which for their own benefits can sell that particular data to many other agencies and organizations, which again can increase the terrorist activities. And this, as the leader of opposition already stated, this is encouraging the terrorism and the terrorist activities rather than bringing it down to a level that we can live in a society such like that. And also, there are certain sections in the IT Act of the country which state that leaking data or keeping data without the consent or permission of the particular person is a crime. When you're stating that in certain sections of the IT Act, how can the government itself promote such a thing when it is already a crime? I'd like to end here. Am I audible?
Yes.
May I start?
Yes, government, please start.
Right, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, let's clarify this in the very beginning. This is not a debate on what article of constitution applies and what does not. This is a debate on whether or not the interests of the most vulnerable stakeholders in this country right now, which are the people at the risk of violence daily, are their lives not important to us or this house or not, ladies and gentlemen. Let's start by identifying what we have to prove to you. Aside, government has to come to you and tell you that potentially infringing on citizens' privacy leads to a better world where there is less violence and less lives are lost. While side opposition has to come to you and tell you that why infringing on privacy is such a big cause, that we can let people die, that we can let their lives not be destroyed, let families not be destroyed just because we want to safeguard some vague idea of privacy. And as I go about discussing the themes of this debate and rebutting what the last speaker said, I think it will be incredibly clear to you why we win this particular debate. Let's clarify who are the stakeholders on both sides. On our side, these are the people who live in violence hit areas, who are at risk from terrorist outfits. And while on their side, they are citizens in general. So the first theme that we'll be discussing here are the question of misuse, not the question of national security, the idea of consent, and the outcomes on both sides. Let us talk about the question of misuse first. They come to us and tell us that the government can misuse this idea of getting data by using it against protesters and not just anti-national elements. Except we come and tell you that there's always a mechanism to ensure that the government does not infringe upon your rights entirely. We talk about the Right to Information Act. We talk about how at the end of the day, we live in a democracy where the government is accountable to its people. And if it goes ahead and commits a crime against its own people, it will not come into power. And that itself is enough incentive for it to not commit crimes. Then the DLO comes and brings up this idea of how Arogya Setu is an infringement on privacy. Except, ladies and gentlemen, I think it's incredibly... And then they talk about how it was updated multiple times. I think, ladies and gentlemen, that is entirely proof of the fact that, the government is can be held accountable. Because against Arogya Setu, they at multiple times, multiple people expressed outrage, about its with respect to privacy, with respect to safety, and the fact that the government listened and updated its app and ensured that the privacy, the data could not be misused, is proof of the fact that the that the possibility of misuse is mitigated here, and that the privacy will be kept intact. Secondly, ladies and gentlemen, and this is the thing that's more important, most important to this debate, is the question of national security and safety of data. We come to you and we tell you that at this point of time, there are multiple conflicts, not only at the international level, but also within groups in the country. At that point of time, safety of people's lives becomes paramount, right? Except they come to you and tell you that there's right to privacy in the Kutuswami case. That's exactly why we cannot have national security. And secondly, they come to you and tell you that data hack ho jayega and like anti-national elements can use it. Except we come to you and clarify this to you in the like in our second speech itself. Okay, that listen, right to privacy can also, like according to that very judgment, can also be infringed upon in cases where national security is paramount. And then we also tell you that at this point of time, data is not, the only question, the only difference that will exist when in our paradigm is that the data will be stored with the government. It's not like the data isn't accessible to anyone, isn't stored anywhere else now. We have private servers like those of Facebook, WhatsApp, that have your data right now. We have, in fact, even the government has data right at this particular point of time on your taxation, on your banking. And the fact that there are so less cases of that data being infringed upon proves that the data is safe. Thirdly, the idea of consent. We come to you and we tell you that when a citizen votes for a particular party, and we tell you that it's when the policy is written in the manifesto, they give the explicit consent. Except DLO comes to us and tells us that there's no consent without any analysis to like why, how they're arriving at that particular conclusion. And like, this is the whole point of elections democracy, where you highlight your policies in your manifesto, and when people vote for you, they express their agreement, and that is exactly what consent means. What happens here, ladies and gentlemen? Side government comes to you and establishes to you a world where people are not dying, where there is a possibility of families not being destroyed, and at the same time, we give to you a mechanism as to how people's privacy will not be infringed on how this data will not be misused. Side opposition comes to you and tells you, it's okay for people to die. It's okay for families to be destroyed just because we have some vague idea that the government will misuse this data. I think it's incredibly clear who has won this. Thank you so much.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are. You may start.
Okay. Just give me 1 sec. I'll set my timer too because I'm unable to hear the bell. Okay, I'll start now. So, opposition film will divide her speech into two parts. Firstly, I would like to take out the points which all the three speakers of government just said, because to be honest, they just repeated each other's points. So, I don't see a point of three other people speaking the same things. And then after pointing out their mistakes, I would then keep my concluding point of my leader and my deputy leader. First speaker of the government, that is the Honorable Prime Minister, the Prime Minister said that whatever problems that happen due to privacy, as we are saying that the privacy should not be taken away, and in later if the problems would happen with any international forum or any other platform like Facebook or LinkedIn, Instagram for that matter, wherever we give our data, also let me apply, we give the data by consent. Taken in the court. So should I assume that the government is right now just saying that they won't help the citizens, the opposition, the citizens who are here debating on the problem of the situation of privacy? And secondly, also the Prime Minister pointed out that there is already so much violence going on, ongoing, and if they don't have our data, how are they going to protect us? I would just like to take this moment and ask you all to think, is that violence even stopping by already primary data which you have of ours, and we are not aware of what other methods you are acquiring our data? Because exactly you are proving my point that there is no mechanism set up. All three of the speakers pointed out we are going to set up I think the deputy speaker for the government said we are going to set up two-fold mechanism. When is that setup going to come? The existing laws nowhere protect our data, and the existing laws nowhere hold you accountable as well. Secondly, when we talk about accountability, right now, the situation of pandemic, the PM fund has been denied access under the purview of RTI. Right to information is what the government is promising us when we have a doubt regarding our own data. But we right now
are not aware where our funds, if we have contributed or donated, are going. If you can, at a situation of pandemic, deny us right to information, how can we trust our data randomly with the government, and then later in questioning, how can we trust that you are going to use it in a very positive or very productive way? Thirdly, they also pointed out that during elections, if something is wrong going on, they will what do you say? They will assure the voters that they won't misuse it. So I would also like to it's very disheartening to hear this, that you are going to perform your socialistic activities only during elections, and otherwise rest 4.5 years, the 10-year leaving election, are you going to misuse our data? And that is what you are implying. Also, the whip for the government said that the privacy is not, the current debate is not under the ambit of constitution. And so, honorable government whip, you are saying, are you above the rule of law and the constitution of India? The constitution of India and other policies of scheme, which are actually made for the betterment of the people, you are denying all of that. So in the end, I would just like to conclude whatever my two leader and deputy leader just said, that whatever existing laws, even in the IT Act, the recent amendment which was made, does not hold you accountable. It just solves the problem if some private company misuses the data. That we can take it in a private, that can be solved anywhere under Article 21 with the High Courts or Supreme Court. We don't need you there. We need you to not take our data unnecessarily, which you have been doing. Arogya Setu app, there are so many Arogya Setu fakes app which came up, and the citizens did not know which app to download. Already we have no idea how many of our private data has gone away. Arogya Setu app asks you to enable GPS and Bluetooth. Is that how you handle a pandemic? What are you going to do with Bluetooth? And do you realize in a time of cyber problems and security, how can a ethical or unethical hacker both use a Bluetooth to take away information from a person's device sitting in anywhere in the country? Arogya Setu apps is a clear example of how the government does not firstly secure whatever data they have of us, and that's why we don't trust you with our data, and hence we don't think the government should take any sort of our data. And one point which is debatable a lot, that our data is already out with private companies, or the word here which implies is consent, is already out with consent. If there is an issue with that, we will take up to, if it is a private company, we'll take up the private company courts and we'll solve it there. We'll take up under our fundamental rights. But just because we have some problem, there is judiciary to solve it. You guys cannot just take up with accountability and raise up your hands and say that our data is protected because God. Thank you.
Thank you to both the sides. I would now request Nalin sir and Saurabh sir to give their remarks without declaring the side which has won the debate. Okay. So Saurabh sir, can you go ahead?
Yeah, thank you. Taking into consideration the online medium that we are using, it was quite a lively debate. And the government side essentially tried to argue from a point of view of national security and assured us that the data that we submit would be secured. And they have argued quite vigorously, while the opposition tried to rebut the arguments made by the government. And I think they did it quite well. They were quite articulate. And it was a good debate. Thank you.
Nalin, sir.
Thank you, Aniket, for having me here. And this has been a very lively debate, you know, as my co-adjudicator said, that due to the constraints that we are facing right now. So I'll just come straight to the point. Essentially, the government's major argument was about, you know, revolving around national security and the overriding effect of it and whatnot. They made some fairly good arguments and fairly good rebuttals as well. Whereas the opposition side also made some very coherent arguments, rebutting them from the point of, you know, liberty and freedom and your choice to not disclose your information, you know, and many other points which are rebutted by each other. We're giving a new shape to the debate. I enjoyed it a lot. Let's see how it fares out. Thank you.
Okay. I would request TC-12 and TC-21 to please leave the debate, and the adjudicators also. You will be notified prior to your next round, the adjudicators. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.